I'm very upset. Wait a minute. Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Okay, so today we are going to talk about drugs that lower plasma lipid levels. This lecture would be comprised of, this lesson actually, this topic would be comprised of two lectures. Today, I will give you a bit of the introduction about what exactly the lipids are doing harm to our body, and one class of drug I'll explain only. In the next lecture, I will explain the other three drugs, and then our chapter of cardiovascular diseases would be over. Okay, so first of all, talking about what does lipid do to our body? Why we don't want that? Okay, so the thing is this. You see, lipids are insoluble, okay? So what they can do is this, they can actually form plaques, all right? And then you see, blood pressure would be higher. So we can develop so many different diseases just because of this primary, reason. A person can even develop stroke because of the atherosclerotic diseases. All right, the person can even have a heart attack because the coronary artery can be blocked. So many diseases can be there because of one reason, that the cholesterol level of the blood is really high. And whenever the blood's cholesterol level is high, so a person should take really good care and should start doing exercise and should start taking good diet in order to avoid the negative aspects, which can be really lethal. Okay. All right. So I'm sure you all have heard about this thing, that there are bad cholesterol and there are good cholesterol. Now, why do we say that? You see, one is low density lipoproteins and other one is high density lipoproteins, HDL, LDL. Maybe this question will also be there in your mind, that why exactly right now Ms. Faiza was talking about cholesterol and all of a sudden she is using the terminology lipoprotein. So what happens is, if you remember in grade 12, I guess you studied about how Golgi apparatus works and everything. Okay. So what happens is the lipids, they cannot stay suspended within the plasma, because plasma is polar in nature, all right? And this lipid is not polar in nature. So what happens is, this lipid is actually modified by combining with proteins, all right? So now the thing is, we want to have more of the HDL and less of the LDL, okay? Please excuse me. Sorry. Okay. All right. So the thing is, the more HDL we have, it's better for our heart. The less HDL we have, it's bad for our heart. Okay. All right. So why do we even need HDL? We need HDL because it removes cholesterol from the bloodstream. And we don't need LDL because it delivers cholesterol to the body. All right? Okay. So, wait, I have a message from you guys. All right. Mohsen, when we talk about HDL, okay, it is good for the body because you see, it's saying that it removes cholesterol from the bloodstream. Now, imagine it serves as a courier, okay? It takes the cholesterol from the bloodstream, it sends it to the liver, okay, where it's being used up, all right? It's being stored, or maybe it's even used, all right? So that is why HDL is good. HDL is found in nuts. Wait, I have one more message from you guys. Okay. All right. That is why you see, we hear so in so many diets, if you look, that are published online from the good universities, so you will find that in all of the diets which are produced by good dietitians and good students of the different renowned universities, you will find that the day starts with taking nuts, you know, some kind of peanut or some kind of nuts they're taking, because they want the HDL to be there. And I tell you what, some amount of cholesterol should be there in the body, should be there in the body. You see, less than 100 is good for our body, because you see our myelin sheath of the neurons, okay, they need fat, all right? So it is not that you would all of a sudden just remove the oil from your diet and would stop eating anything that is fatty in nature. No, you should not do that, okay? Because yes, we do need fat. Even under our skin, we do have a subcutaneous layer, all right? We do have a fatty layer which actually insulates our body. So we need that fat, all right? But not in a large amount that will produce lethal effects. All right. So dietary or pharmacological reduction of elevated plasma cholesterol level can reduce the risk of atherosclerosis and subsequent cardiovascular disease. The association between cardiovascular disease and elevated plasma triglycerides is less dramatic. Now, when I'm saying triglyceride, so that brings another question in my mind, which I'm giving you as a homework, and you have to do it. You have to tell me that what are the types of HDL and LDL, okay? What kind of plasma lipids are there in our body? Here I have talked about triglyceride. I've also talked about cholesterol, all right? So I want you to explore, all right? Okay, so the association between cardiovascular disease and elevated plasma triglyceride is less dramatic. Elevated triglyceride can produce life-threatening pancreatitis. Now, we will talk about how to control the condition where we would have an increased amount of lipoprotein in our blood. All right. So, hyperlipoproteinemia. Cholesterol is a non-polar, like I said before, poorly water-soluble substance transported in the plasma in particles that have a hydrophobic core of cholestyrene esters and triglycerides surrounded by a coat of phospholipids, free cholesterol, and one or more apoproteins. These lipoprotein particles vary in the ratio of triglyceride to cholesterol ester as well as in the type of apoprotein. They are identified as low density lipoproteins, LDL particles. VLDL, IDL, and then HDL, all right? So the diseases of plasma lipids can be manifest as an elevation in triglyceride or as an elevation in cholesterol, all right? So because of the elevation of either of the two factors, diseases of plasma lipids can happen. In several of the complex or combined hyperlipoproteinemias, both triglyceride and cholesterol can be elevated. So talking about the drugs that will treat, here, like I said in the start of the lecture, we will be covering four classes of drugs, you can say. Today, I'm going to talk about statins. And in the upcoming lecture, I will talk about the other three drugs or the other three classes. And then we'll be done with this entire chapter. Anyways, so statins. Statins are the inhibitors of cholesterol biosynthesis. In my next lecture, I will try to include the biochemistry of cholesterol synthesis as well, all right? So we can actually get into it and we can talk about it. So these drugs include lovastatin, simvastatin, pravastatin, atorvastatin, and rosuvastatin. So these drugs that inhibit cholesterol biosynthesis are quite effective at lowering LDL cholesterol and total cholesterol. So what is the mechanism? These drugs function as competitive inhibitor of HMG-CoA reductase. And that is actually the rate limiting enzyme in the cholesterol biosynthesis. Reduced cholesterol synthesis results in compensatory increase in the hepatic uptake of plasma cholesterol mediated by increase in the number of LDL receptors. So these drugs reduce total cholesterol by as much as 30 to 50%. LDL cholesterol can be reduced by as much as 60%. So the therapeutic uses, inhibitors of cholesterol biosynthesis are effective in reducing the cholesterol level in hypercholesterolemias. Whenever you see this terminology, you should actually break it up, because this emia means blood, hyper means more, cholesterol, it means that cholesterol is an excessive amount within the blood. So recent clinical trials have established that statins interfere with osteoclast-mediated bone resorption and may reduce osteoporosis. So these drugs may also interfere with intracellular localization of certain oncogenes and thereby reduce the incidence of some cancers. They also have weak anti-inflammatory activity and reduce stroke risk, because obviously they are reducing, right, the cholesterol. So the negative effects, the adverse effects of these drugs include myositis. So that is actually the muscle cells, they get inflamed. Then we have rhabdomyolysis. So what is that? I have a slide for that. You see, the muscles actually start to die. All right. And then the dead muscles, they tear away and they enter into the bloodstream. All right. And because of that, they actually get flushed out of the out through the urine. All right. And then the urine is actually very dark in color. If you Google this thing, rhabdomyolysis, urine, and then you look at the images, so they have actually placed images where the actual urine, this is of course a diagram, but they have actual urine samples which are shared. All right. So anxiety, irritability, hepatotoxicity, and elevation in aminotransferase. However, yearly liver function tests are no longer recommended. That is it for today, everybody.